will either find in your package or will be able to download from the site, and I will go through it in a few minutes. But what I'd like to do before that is provide some introductory remarks and motivate the discussion. During the coffee break, a group of us were talking about issues related to currency and agriculture. And one of the points that we made is that the whole question of exchange rate policy has had a cyclical life within the agricultural economics field. It comes and goes, at the current time, it's not as central to the discussion as it was at some point in the past. I would like to argue that from the point of view of the field and the health of agricultural economics in general, those periods within the cycle when exchange rate policy is not at the center of the discussion are unhealthy. Peru's neighbor to the south, Chile, and its current predicament. As all of you know, about a few weeks ago, Chile was hit by one of the most devastating earthquakes in the history of the modern world. It's the fifth hardest, strongest earthquake ever recorded. The most devastating one was also in Chile in 1960, and this is the number five. And you've seen the destruction on TV, CNN and BBC and other news organizations have been quite persistent in showing what happened. And there are two things that come up. The first one is that for the strength of the earthquake, the country did very well. And this speaks very highly of Chilean engineers and building codes. The situation is basically the result of learning by doing. Because in 1960, when the hardest, strongest earthquake ever recorded hit, the devastation was amazing. And there has been learning by doing, and that is something that, of course, we value, learning by doing. But the second point, and the one that I really want to bring to your attention, is that Chile, with all its remarkable macroeconomic management of the last 20 years, is facing a very, very difficult time in deciding how to reconstruct the country. And the problem has to do with the exchange rate, and it has to do with the exchange rate and the agricultural sector. And this is what's going on. This is a country that has done everything by the book, that during the good years when the price of copper was higher than what was considered by all the gurus in the world to be a normal and long-term sustainable price, Chile put away significant amounts of money and built, just like the Norwegians, a sovereign fund to be used during the lean years after having been accumulated during the fat years of good copper price. Not only that, the government of Chile made sure to pay off most of its debt. And today, Chile's debt to GDP ratio is around 7%. Compare that to Germany or the US, about 90%, France, 90%, Greece, 140%, and we can go on and on and on. Here is a country that deliberately decided to pay its debt and has no debt, meaning that it could issue bonds in the international marketplace tomorrow and sell them at a spread that would be the envy of most OECD countries. And would be and I can assure you, because I talk to them, hedge fund managers, pension fund managers, investment managers from around the world would fight among themselves in order to get some Chilean paper to add to their portfolios, because it's beautiful to diversify, it has a low covariance with the rest of the portfolio. It's an A country, it may soon be an AA minus country, but with Standard & Poor's. And yet, there is no way Chile can actually tap the international markets, because if it does, it will generate foreign exchange, and it will have to sell it in order to actually finance a reconstruction, and that will strengthen the currency, which is already very strong. Why? Because the price of copper continues to be very high, and that will depress the degree of competitiveness of the agricultural sector, and wine producers and fresh flour producers and fresh produce and agribusinesses are not going to survive if this happens. So there is this central dilemma that is not related to the financing sector, financial sector, is not related to the macroeconomy in general. It is fundamentally one that affects the agricultural sector, the export sector in general, but the agricultural sector. And any country that today is trying to modernize its agricultural sector in the sense of making it possible for it to create the types of jobs that would definitely lift people from poverty, that is trying to improve the infrastructure in order to be able to export goods with increasing value-added content, any country under those circumstances is going to suffer if the currency strengthens more than what it should. So I'm going to talk in this, or I talk in this paper about some lessons on exchange rate policy, mostly from Latin America, but not exclusively, and some of them are related to the case of Asia. And the way I've organized the paper, and I want you to keep in mind the what I said about Chile as a background, is by reviewing a long body of research and by presenting to you what I call 9 regularities on exchange rate policy, mostly learned from Latin America and Asia. I was going to have 10 regularities, but I thought that 10 was too cute a number, too nice a number, so I decided that 9 was a better number. It will call your attention. So I will go quickly. Before moving, let me just point out to you that one of the great contrasts between Asia and Latin America through the years has been that, among many things, that Latin America has been plagued by currency crises. There have been currency crises in Asia, but much less so than in Latin America. And Latin America, as opposed to Asia, and in particular East Asia, and now South Asia as well, Latin America, through the years, has experimented with every single type of exchange rate arrangement. And there you have a list of all the ones that have been used during the last few years. So let me go through the 9 empirical irregularities on currencies in Latin America. And I will go rather quickly, and then if we have time, we can talk about them in the discussion. Some of these will be pretty obvious to you, but the fact that they are obvious, I can assure you, does not mean that mistakes that will contradict these lessons are going to be made in the next 10 years. I can absolutely assure that when we meet 10 years from now, when Maximo and his colleagues reconvene this group 10 years from now, we're going to look back at 2010, and we're going to say, oh my God, so many countries made so many mistakes and violated the lessons that we discussed in Lima at that time. It's going to be a pity, but that is going to happen. The first regularity is that exchange rate crises are extremely costly. And that should not be a surprise, but let me put things in perspective. Here you have some regressions. You can see all of this in the paper. If you define an exchange rate crisis as a situation like, I'm not going to talk here about Argentina or some collapse of biblical proportions, as something that, like what Spain is suffering today, Spain. Spain, an advanced country that has banks that own most of the banking sector in Latin America. It has banks that have been called the safest banks in the world. The Spanish firms own and have investment in infrastructure all over the world. And Spain today is going through a crisis that is quite significant, and they have had to have a current account reversal. They have had to compress their current account deficit by a significant amount. That type of current account reversal of at least 4% of GDP has happened in Latin America to each country on average once every 10 years during the last 50 years. It's an event that happens once every 10 years. If you are able to completely avoid a currency crisis or an external crisis of that type, after one generation The country without the crisis would have a GDP that is 40% higher than the average Latin American country. So it adds up in such a significant way that after a generation, after 25, 30 years, the difference between the two countries is like the difference between, I would say, Colombia and Portugal today. And that, of course, is extremely, extremely costly. So lesson number one, currency crises are very, very costly. We should do everything we can to avoid them. A very interesting issue is that a few years back, there was a discussion on what we call sudden stops of capital flows. And that's what we saw with the financial crisis in the last 2 years. Greece has been affected by a sudden stop lately. So has Spain and Ireland. Sudden stops are very costly. But what this research shows is that it's not the sudden stop itself, but it is the related need to compress the current account deficit. And that is extremely, that is what generates these very, very large costs in terms of reduction in growth, reduction in employment, increase in unemployment, and so on and so forth. The second regularity is that in the long run, countries with flexible exchange rates tend to grow faster than countries with rigid exchange rates. I've been told that I have very, very, very little time, so I'm just going to go through these regularities. We may discuss them later. And each of these regularities, I have here some evidence. Regularity number three is that countries that give up their currency do not necessarily outperform countries that maintain their own currency. And the current situation in Greece shows that that indeed may be the case. And of course, Greece is facing the dilemma that they don't have the shock absorber. They cannot adjust relative prices on the one hand. On the other hand, they still are able to sell debt at incredibly low prices relative to the riskiness involved in the macroeconomics, and there are costs and benefits. But the evidence shows that if you give up your country and you dollarize, as Ecuador and other countries have done, that does not necessarily result in better performance. The regularity number four is that countries with flexible exchange rates, I'm not saying freely floating rates, I'm just saying flexible rates, are able to accommodate external shocks better. And the fact that Latin America hasn't collapsed during the last crisis is 100% a reflection of this principle. In Latin America, with very few exceptions, most countries have flexible rates. That's not floating rates. That's not freely determined, market-determined rates, but flexible rates. And they were able, the countries of Latin America. Brazil is a beautiful example. The currency depreciated, and then it appreciated. And today, of course, it over-appreciated, and many people are worried that it is overvalued. And regularity number five, under capital mobility and fixed exchange rate, there is no room for independent monetary policy. And I'll get to this in a second. This is the impossibility of the Holy Trinity. And this says that if you have fixed exchange rates and capital mobility, then you cannot have independent monetary policy. So you cannot have all three things at the same time. You have to give up one of them. And there's new research that suggests that short-term controls that control capital inflows may help if you want to get monetary independence. Regularity number six is that exchange rate policy is based on exchange inflation rate differentials, the so-called tablitas, generate incredibly persistent inflation, and countries that do this are going to end up losing their anchor. Regularity number seven, which is related to the previous one, is that if you have had a system where the currency value, Korea had a system that was very similar. It was called the alpha factor in Korea, that basically the currency was depreciated at a rate that was equal to inflation rate differentials in the past, plus an alpha factor, and no one knew what alpha was. And I remember spending weeks after weeks in Seoul trying to discover what the alpha factor was. And we were like Sherlock Holmes. We went from office to office asking different officials about the alpha factor and trying. And once we thought we knew what it was, the next official would give us tell us a story that clearly showed that we didn't have it right. So once you've had this inflation differential-based exchange rate policies where you depreciate according to inflation rate differential, the country gets in an incredible amount of inertia, and it's bound to lose its anchor. And you're bound to have a situation like the one that Brazil had in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, which is you start with 40% inflation, then you get a shock, you move to 100, another shock, you move to 200, another shock, you move to 400, another shock, you move to 1,000, and then you move to 2,000. And when the Real Plan under future President Fernando Henrique Cardoso was put in place, inflation was 2,000%. And the anchor was completely lost. And once you put in place the stabilization program, there is a temptation of using fixed exchange rates to bring inflation down. And that is also very dangerous. And that calls for an exit strategy. That means you have to use this only for a certain period of time. And if you use it for a longer period of time, you're going to greatly overvalue your currency. And that is going to be very, very dangerous. And this, of course, this situation has echoes of what happened in the 1910s, the 1920s, actually, during the gold standard. And if you haven't read the book by my good friend and former colleague, Liaquat Ahmed, on the Great Depression and the gold standard, you definitely should. It's called Lords of Finance, and it's a beautiful, beautiful book about central banking and the loss of competitiveness that greatly affected the agricultural sector. The Great Depression in the US, people think it was a story about bankers jumping off buildings and about Detroit being unable to sell cars. The Great Depression was mostly about farmers in the US suffering from disinflation. And this is something that we should not forget, and this is related to regularity number 7. Regularity number 8 is that exchange rate misalignment may be very dangerous and very important. You can still have misalignment under floating rates. And today, there is calculations, for instance, that New Zealand is misaligned, that, of course, other currencies are misaligned and overvalued or undervalued, including Japan and others, and it's very costly. Regularity number 9. And I'll have very little time or no time. I'll spend 1 minute here. There's a great asymmetry between overvaluation and undervaluation. And the reason why this is a very important regularity is because, of course, at the core of it is the case of China and other Asian countries, whose currencies are not overvalued, but are undervalued. And if your currency is overvalued, it is more costly than if it is undervalued. In fact, from a particular country's point of view, the case, it's not so easy to make a strong case for saying that undervaluing the currency is very costly. Undervaluing the currency maintains competitiveness, maintains predictability, allows exporters to know what to do, allows exporters to continue to export, allows the country to modernize through exports, and all of that is good. Now, it creates inflationary pressures, it creates problems through the monetization of the current account surplus, it forces countries to sterilize, and that can be very costly. If the cost of sterilization is very hard, then you start performing surgery with a big machete, like the Chinese have done lately by increasing reserve requirements to the level that they have, instead of sterilizing in a modern way by issuing paper. But the costs of even performing surgery with a big machete are not as large as the cost that occur if instead of having undervalued currency, you have an overvalued currency and you run out of reserves and you have a big currency collapse. The problem, of course, is that large countries are different. And the problem when we talk about these issues is the big elephant in the room, as it were, is the case of China. And China is a very large, very, very important country. And the problem is that while what is good for China is not necessarily good for the world. What is good for Germany, which is the other large country with a big surplus, is not necessarily good for the world. And the problem is that as these countries grow and become bigger and bigger, they are the world. So at some point, what is good for the world is going to be good for China. And I have been traveling the world and for years telling my Chinese friends, don't pay any attention to what the Americans say. Don't pay any attention to what the Europeans say. Maintain your currency as undervalued as you want. Be competitive. Do what you're doing. You're doing a wonderful job. The reason why these guys are getting nervous is because you're making progress. But we have reached a point where it's very hard now for me or for others to maintain and to keep making that point because China is too important. So they've been too successful. And now they are the world. Not alone, but with 3 or 4 other countries. And what is good for China is not good for them. So I think that when we talk about Asia, the big question is going to be China. And not only on its own, but because so many countries are looking to China and are going to increasingly look at currency policy in China in order to determine what their own currency policies are going to be. And what the currency policies are going to be, I want to go back and I'm going to say, is fundamental for the agricultural sector in more ways than what most people think. And at the end of the story, these nine lessons, if one pays attention to them, one can, I think, have a policy framework that if not, that even if it doesn't result in a takeoff, a dramatic takeoff of the agricultural sector, at least it will not hurt it. It will provide the right incentives and will allow the agricultural farmers of all sizes in the agricultural sector and in the even in the non-agricultural rural sector to start contributing even more to their country's well-being and in that way reducing poverty and helping them move towards prosperity. I have another section in the paper which I recommend you read. I'm not going to talk about it except to tell you about it, which is why in Latin America for 25 or 30 years, in spite of the fact that they were forewarned, policymakers continued to make currency mistakes. If you look at what happened in Argentina, at what happened in Mexico, at what happened in Uruguay, now all of these countries are doing fine or okay, so now we say, well, so what? But they would have had today a GDP per capita that would be 20% higher if they had not had those crises. Why did they make these mistakes? And what I discuss in the paper is the sociology, if you want, of policymaking. And the fact that these policy mistakes are recurrent, and I'm afraid that we haven't seen the last of these mistakes. They will reappear in the future, and as I said when I started, when Maximo and his colleagues reconvened this group in this beautiful city of Lima, we are going to say, oh my God, once again, some countries made these awful mistakes, in spite of the fact that we all warned them not to make them. Thank you very much.